Penguin Random House Audio presents Where Am I Now? True Stories of Girlhood and Accidental Fame. This is the author, Mara Wilson. For my mother, Susie. Prologue. A few years ago, I found a video of myself on YouTube. It's from what I like to call my sordid past as a child actor. Like many moments in my childhood, I have no memory of it, but I do have a record. I'm sitting next to Robin Williams, who is dressed and made up like a woman. We're on the set of Mrs. Doubtfire. The director is filming us so we can see what Robin's makeup looks like on camera, but I don't seem to know that. I am taking it very seriously. "What's your name?" Robin says, affecting a slight Scottish brogue. I look puzzled. "Do I say my real name?" I whispered to the girl beside me, an older girl with long dark hair. This is Lisa Jacob, who is playing my big sister in Doubtfire. She will go on to become my honorary big sister in real life. "It doesn't matter," she whispers back. "My name is Mara," I say to him quietly. It's obvious, watching it now, that I'm not sure if I was supposed to say that. He tells me it's a beautiful name and that I'm wearing a beautiful dress and asks me what I like to do. I shrug. "We could make up stories. Do you like to make up stories?" he asks, trying again. 5-year-old me sits up a little straighter. He has said the magic word. "Yeah, sometimes I like to make up stories," I say. When I was a little girl, there was nothing better to me than a story. I loved books, and I liked telling my own stories, too. I don't know exactly when I started telling them, but once I did, I never stopped. Sometimes I would even sing them. And these weren't just anecdotes or neat little fairy tales. They were more like epic poems, tales of adventure and morality to rival Virgil and Homer, at least in terms of length, if not quality. A shorter story could take all day, and one of my longer sagas lasted the entire summer between preschool and kindergarten. It got to the point where whenever I said, "I have a story," one of my brothers would cut me off, applauding and saying, "Oh, good story," before I'd even started. Unaware that I have yet to learn about pacing, and that this story could potentially go on for days, Robin asks if I want to tell him one. So I go ahead, launching into a story about a bunny who went out into the woods when he should have waited for his parents to go with him. It's a morality tale, full of suspense, and a man or rabbit versus nature motif, especially after the bunny is thrown from his raft into a raging river. Robin nods along for the first minute, but as the story continues, he seems to be wondering how much longer it will go on. Finally, I announce that the daddy bunny saved the baby bunny and lectured him. The mommy gave him medicine, and everyone had pie. The end. At that point, Robin lets out a low whistle, looks directly into the camera, and says, "We'll be right back." I don't remember filming that video. I don't remember telling that story. Yet, watching it as a 20-something, I felt a remarkable sense of familiarity. If there has been a narrative theme in my life, it has been a need to find a narrative in everything. I found an audience as an actor. But even then, I spent all my time between shots sitting in my trailer, writing stories and screenplays. Adults would ask me if I wanted to continue being an actor when I grew up, and I would say, "Maybe, but I want to be a writer." From the time I broke up with Hollywood, more on that later, and moved to New York City, I've devoted myself to stories. As a playwright, oral storyteller, and host of my own storytelling show. And now, here I am, once again telling my stories to anyone who will listen. Mostly, my stories are about being young and a little out of place. It's how I felt most of my life. I was born the first girl after 3 boys, the only Jewish kid in my class, the only girl I knew whose mother had died, the only neurotic in Southern California, or so it seemed, and the only child on film sets full of adults. I was always in someone else's world, and I always knew it. This, I've learned, is a far more common feeling than I once imagined. But not everything about my experience has been universal. A few months after I found the video of Robin and me, it was taken down, apparently due to copyright infringement. I had to laugh. Most people have embarrassing videos of themselves as children. Few have theirs copyrighted by 20th Century Fox. The Junior Anti-Sex League. My mother could not have picked a worse time to teach me about sex. One night, when I was 5 years old, she turned on the TV to a special about sex education. Kids my brother Danny's age were holding bags of flour, calling them their babies, and scrambling to find babysitters for them. "Why are they doing that?" I said. "They're learning about babies, how to take care of them, and how they're made," she said. "Oh." I knew the last part. They were made in their mother's bellies. I had seen my mother pregnant with my sister. But now the kids on the screen were in a classroom, and a teacher was talking to them about cells and body parts. "What's she talking about?" I said. "She's explaining sex to them." I had heard that word before. I knew it was a loaded term, something grown-ups only said in whispers. "What is that?" "It's how you make a baby," she said, and went on to describe the most absurd, unappealing process I could imagine. She'd always believed in telling children the truth, at least to the extent that they were capable of understanding. She was open about private parts and calling them by their real names. Her instincts about openness and honesty were right on, but still, I was horrified. "You did that?" I blurted out. She nodded, and with a sickening feeling, I counted up myself, my brothers, and sister, and realized she must have done it at least 5 times. "Any other questions?" I had only one more. "When you did it, did you say whoa?" My mother had the best of intentions. She made it clear this was not something to be discussed in polite company, that it needed to be kept a secret. But I had a tendency to blurt out secrets. I've always been compulsively honest, and usually at the wrong times. 5 months earlier, I had ruined my father's birthday surprise party by asking, "You don't know about our cakes, right?" Objectively speaking, sex seemed shockingly gross and ridiculous. But as the shock wore off, the world felt different. I could tell that sex was a big deal. It was something new and exciting, a secret grown-ups kept to themselves. Just knowing about it made me feel powerful. I had to tell someone. And I had a big scene on the set of Mrs. Doubtfire the next day. It was not my mother who had gotten me into acting. Not really. She was not a stage mother. But she was an actress. She had studied theater in college and never missed an opportunity to perform. My brothers and I went to Theodore Roosevelt Elementary School, and every year on Teddy Roosevelt's birthday, Teddy himself would come by in person. "And I said, don't you dare shoot that bear. They made a little stuffed bear and named it after me, and that's why we call them teddy bears today." Teddy was only about 5'2", with D-cup breasts and a hat I had seen in my mother's closet. But her performance was convincing enough to make some of the kids ask, "Is that really him? I thought he was dead." My mother disappeared into the role, morphing from a tiny woman into one of the most macho men who ever lived. We lived in Burbank, in Southern California's San Fernando Valley, 20 minutes away from Hollywood. My mother always said of our hometown, "It's as if someone picked up a small city in the Midwest and plopped it down in the middle of Los Angeles." Burbank tried its hardest to stay quaint, but it was also home to Warner Brothers, NBC, and Disney Studios. The tentacles of the entertainment industry reached into everyone's lives. My father worked as an electronics engineer at CBS, NBC, and the local channel KTLA. Classmates came to school in cars with license plate frames reading, "Part of the Magic, Walt Disney Company." And my brothers would borrow movie screeners from friends with well-connected parents when we didn't want to wait for video. Given the omnipresence of the entertainment industry, getting into acting wasn't an unusual thing for a Burbank kid to do. Children all over the world do ridiculous, borderline dangerous things, and no one around them questions it because it's ingrained in their culture. So it was with child acting in Southern California. When I was a toddler, the oldest and most outgoing of my siblings, Danny, started trying out for commercials. He was cute and a quick study, booking a few TV ads and even some small parts in movies. Watching my mother and Danny rehearse, I had an epiphany. What they did was like when I performed my stories at home, only better because people wanted to see you perform. Shortly after my 5th birthday, I went right up to my mother and told her, "Mommy, I want to do what Danny does." "No, you don't," she said. They were already starting to feel burned out. She was relieved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.